Happy Easter Sunday. It's really good to see you here this morning. It's an exciting day at Faith Bible Church. We have four morning services. This is the first of four, 8 o'clock, 9:30, 11, and 12:30. So as you leave here today, enriched, encouraged, text your friends, tell them to come to one of the later services. We would love to have them at 9:30, 11, or 12:30. So welcome to Gathered Worship at Faith Bible. If you're waiting on somebody to arrive and you're starting to give up on holding their seat for them, you can text them that there is overflow in the chapel, in the high school room upstairs, and also in the fellowship hall along the east hall right here. So those will be our overflow locations for the morning. You might be mindful of that, but there's still some room in this room, so help people as they walk in here in the next few moments looking for a seat. Hope you grabbed a bulletin on your way in. In that bulletin, you'll find a sermon outline as well as some announcements and other information about opportunities here at Faith Bible Church. If you didn't get one on the way in, be sure and grab one on the way out. If you would now stand, greet one another, and then I'll call us to worship. Remain standing as you make your way back to your seat. Remain standing. The call to worship is from Psalm 150. The psalmist writes, "Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty expanse. Praise him for his mighty deeds. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord." Let's pray together. Father, we come to you in praise today. We have every reason to praise you. In your name and through your Son, and by his victory, we have life everlasting. So we have something we're celebrating today. Be with us as we come to this place. Our desire is to exalt you, is to look at Christ, to see what he's done, to give him great praise, and to celebrate the resurrection together. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Well, indeed, we have every reason to sing with great joy and energy today. Christ the Lord is risen today. You join your voices with us. Let's sing it out.
He is risen, he's alive.
Amen to that. You can be seated this morning.
He is risen. He is risen. Still one more time. He is risen. There we are, all on board. Well, our Easter theme for the last 6 weeks or so has been the death of death and the death of Christ. Just an attempt for us to acknowledge together that Jesus Christ took on our greatest enemy, sin and death, and he triumphed over them. He put an end to the tyranny of death. And Mark's going to be preaching out of 1 Corinthians 15 this morning, but in some of the preceding verses from the text for today's sermon, there's a line that says, "For as in Adam all die." For as in Adam all die. This is why Genesis ends with Joseph's death, and Deuteronomy ends with Moses' death, and Joshua ends with Joshua's death. For as in Adam all die, yet in Christ all will be made alive. And this is why the Gospels end with Jesus' resurrection. And Jesus' resurrection changes everything. I read something this week that says, if Christ is not risen, nothing else matters. And if Christ is risen, nothing else matters. So as we continue to worship the Lord this morning, as we continue to proclaim our love and affection and devotion to him, be mindful that without him, without resurrection life, nothing else matters. Please stand and continue to worship together.
My gracious.
throne of majesty. The Father's will complete. He reigns in victory.
Jesus Christ, my living hope. promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the
God. And thank you most of all that that's true, that Jesus has broken the power of sin and death and hell and the grave forever. Let's pray together. This morning I want to pray a prayer of Hippolytus of Rome. He lived back in the 2nd and 3rd century, a great father of the church. Beautiful prayer. He said, Christ is risen. The world below lies desolate. Christ is risen. The spirits of evil are fallen. Christ is risen. The angels of God are rejoicing. Christ is risen. The tombs of the dead are empty. Christ is risen indeed from the dead, the first of the sleepers. Glory and power are His forever and ever. In the name of the risen Christ, the one death could not hold. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. I want to, first of all, just thank Joel and our worship team for leading us this morning. God bless you guys, man. Awesome. What a blessing. Thank you guys so much. Joel does such an outstanding job shepherding our worship ministry here at Faith Bible Church. And I want to thank each of you for investing your Easter Sunday with us and pray that you'll be richly blessed and encouraged by your time here with us today. You know, Easter Sunday's always a very special day for me, as it is for every believer, should be. It's a spiritual highlight, really spiritual high point of our year in many ways. But this Easter has a much deeper meaning for me than I've ever experienced. As most of you know by now, my father, Dale Hitchcock, went to heaven 25 days ago. And the hope of the resurrection has been more precious and rich and real to me than ever before this year. You know, Jay Reisner came up with our Easter theme for this year, the death of death. And we decided on that theme weeks before my father died. And I had no idea at that time how meaningful this was going to be for me personally, the death of death. The reality of the resurrection of Jesus and His total victory over death has literally flooded my heart with an abiding, inexplicable sense of hope and peace. I'm so grateful for that. The resurrection is immeasurably more alive to me than it's ever been before. This is the greatest Easter that I've ever experienced. I love what G. Campbell Morgan said. He said, Easter should put an everlasting smile on your face. So it should do for us. And I know for any of you who may have lost a loved one recently, who's a believer in Jesus Christ, I know that what I'm saying resonates with you as well. And I pray the Lord will continue to flood your heart with peace as well, a peace that we can have because death is dead. That last enemy has been abolished. It's been defeated, terminated. It's been swallowed up. And that's the message of our text for this Easter morning. 1 Corinthians 15, 54-57. So take your Bible and turn there with me. 1 Corinthians 15, the great resurrection chapter of the Bible. This is the centerpiece of biblical teaching on the doctrine of the truth of the resurrection. Now, we're not going to have time to look at this chapter in any kind of detail, but let me just give you a flyover of 1 Corinthians 15 because we're going to land here and kind of parachute down near the end of this chapter. But in the first 11 verses here, Paul confesses the truth of the resurrection. I've got that little outline there for you in your outline there this morning that I've given to you of the sermon. Paul confesses the truth of the resurrection. Now, I make known to you, brethren, the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, by which you're saved. If you hold fast to the word I preached, unless you believed in vain, I declared to you of his first importance what I received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. Paul confesses the truth of the resurrection. And he goes on and he corroborates and confirms the truth of the resurrection. Jesus goes on a resurrection tour, if you will. One time appears to 500 people. You get down further in the chapter, beginning in verse 35, and the Apostle Paul clarifies the truth of the resurrection. He talks about what kind of body we're going to have when we're raised. He talks about the future resurrection that will take place when the Lord comes. And then finally, when you get down to verse 54, Paul celebrates the truth of the resurrection. And that's what I want to focus on here this morning in verses 54 to 57, the celebration of the resurrection. Let me read these verses for us, beginning in verse 54. But when this perishable will have put on the imperishable, and this mortal will have put on immortality, then will come about the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. May the Lord write his eternal word on our hearts this morning. Back on the evening of June 18th, 1815, there was a man who stood in the tower of England's Winchester Cathedral, gazing anxiously out to sea. The Battle of Waterloo was taking place, and England, of course, was represented by their great general, the Duke of Wellington, fighting against Napoleon Bonaparte. He's waiting for news to transfer across England of how the battle had come out. There's a ship out in the harbor, and they begin to send the message, and as they do, a lot of fog begins to come in. And the message is sent, and the message he receives is, Wellington defeated. Of course, he's cast down in despair, but he begins to signal to the other stations. And it's spread across the countryside, and doom falls over the land of England. But a little while later, when the fog lifts, the man who's on the ship begins to send the message again, and the man in Winchester Cathedral can see it clearly, and it's Wellington defeated the enemy. And joy and happiness, of course, flooded England when the word and the news goes out. But on Good Friday, it seemed like the message was Christ defeated. But on Easter morning, when Jesus came up out of the tomb, the message was Christ defeated the enemy. And that's the message of Easter. Christ has defeated the enemy. He's defeated death. Death is dead. Now, I've got two simple points this morning to unpack these verses, the triumph and the thanks. The triumph and the thanks. We see the triumph in verses 54 to 56. There's a story I read recently about a man who's reviewing his test results with the doctor. And the doctor said to him, I'm very sorry, but you have a terminal disease. And the guy said, well, doc, how long do I have to live? And the doctor said, 10. And the guy said, well, 10 what? Days, months, years? The doctor said, 9, 8, 7, 6. Death is a universal enemy, right? And it often comes far too quickly. In fact, you know, death really always comes quickly. Life is short. We realize that the older we get, it passes by like a puff of smoke. But according to Scripture, there's going to be an entire generation of people that will not die. They're going to do an end run on the grave. You'll notice back up in chapter 15 here, the context in verse 51, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, the last trumpet will sound. The dead will be raised imperishable. Those believers who've died, their bodies are going to be raised. When they died, their spirit went immediately into the presence of Christ. When he returns, their body is going to be resurrected, perfected, glorified, immortal, imperishable body. That's going to be rejoined with the perfected spirit. And those who are alive will be changed, will go through an instantaneous change, body, soul, and spirit, perfected in a moment of time and caught up to be with the Lord. And so he's looking to that future time when the bodies will be resurrected and the living will be raptured and caught up to be with Christ. Now, while this resurrection is going to be fully realized in the future, it's invaded the present. And Paul quotes two Old Testament texts that prophesy the cessation of death. The first one there in verse 54 is, death is swallowed up in victory. He says, when this perishable will have put on the imperishable, look into the future, and this mortal will have put on immortality, then will come about the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Now, back in Isaiah 25, literally it says, he will swallow up death forever. But Paul substitutes the word victory here for forever. Death is swallowed up in victory. It's swallowed up in triumph. You know, whenever someone dies that we love very much, it looks like death has swallowed them up, doesn't it? It looks like they've been swallowed up in death. We have to remember, for the believer in Jesus Christ, death has been swallowed up. Death has been swallowed up in victory. As Paul says in 2 Timothy 1:10, Christ has abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Death swallowed up. And then Paul loosely quotes here from Hosea 13:14. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? Now, Paul here is unrestrained. This is a powerful, really, the way this is written. Paul is mocking death. He's taunting it. If you wanted to put it in our words today, Paul is trash-talking death. He's saying, death, where's your victory? Oh, grave, where's your sting? He's talking smack, if you will, to death. Back in 1965, some of you alive during that time may remember this, it's called the most iconic photo in all of sports. It was the rematch between Muhammad Ali and Sonny Liston. And Ali knocked out Liston, I think it was in the first round. It was 1965, and there's that iconic picture of Muhammad Ali. He's standing over Sonny Liston. He's got his glove like this, and he's saying to him, get up and fight, get up and fight. And he's taunting him as he's lying there on the canvas. And that's what Paul is doing here to death. He's taunting death in light of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. One man I read this week put it like this. It says, Paul's saying, come on, death, show me what you got. You've got nothing left because Jesus has evacuated you of your power. Where, O death, is that victory that everybody fears? Where is that sting? It's gone. It's gone. And notice in verse 56, he says that the sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. You say, well, what does he mean by that? Well, it's by sin that death gains authority over us. It's the law that exposes sin for what it is. So what he's saying here is death gets its power from sin. It's death that has the real, sin that's the real stinger here. If sin is robbed of its power, then so too is death. So when Christ dies for our sins, he conquers our sins, but in conquering our sins, he also conquers death. And he says that the power of sin is the law. In other words, the law is the mirror that you and I look into that shows us what we really are. It's the mirror that shows us that we fail to meet its demands. So the sting of death is sin, but the power of sin is the law that reveals to us how far short we fall of God's commands. You know, the sting of death is sin, which reminds us that the cause of human death is not ultimately medical, it's moral. Ultimately, it's moral. We don't simply die because of medical complications or natural human processes. We die because of a deadly poison called sin. Romans 5:12 tells us that death came through sin. Of course, Jesus died, but unlike others, he didn't die because of his sin. He died for sin. He became sin for us as he hung there on the cross and died in our place. And Jesus took the sting of death when he died for our sins. He's drawn out the poison, if you will. He's absorbed it in his own person there on the cross. He took the sting for us. When I was growing up, every vacation we ever took was to visit my grandparents and my aunts and uncles in Springfield, Missouri. And I loved it that way. I mean, we got to go see all of our family there. But my grandparents, the first house I remember them living in was a little small place outside of Springfield called Willard. And they had some land back behind. There was a huge field even behind the fence of their house. But we loved baseball back then. This was back in the 1960s. Baseball was even bigger than football back then. And they all loved the St. Louis Cardinals, being from Springfield, Missouri. And we would play what, in my mind, as a little kid, were epic wiffle ball games. And we played, you know, plastic ball. We'd go out there hours upon hours. That's all we did, was go out in the backyard and play with those plastic balls, this huge backyard. But one of the things about the yard, it was filled with clover. So being filled with clover, there were always lots of bees buzzing around. And our games would often be temporarily interrupted by screams of a bee sting. That would happen almost every game, and it's just clover everywhere, everybody running around. But the first time I remember someone getting stung, I saw the bee flying around, and we all began to run and, you know, in sheer terror, you know, from this bee. And it wasn't until later that night, when I told my dad what happened, that I learned that once a bee stings someone, it loses its stinger, and it can't hurt anybody else. In fact, after stinging someone, actually a honeybee dies, because as the bee tries to pull the stinger out of the skin, it injures itself so severely that it actually dies. So in stinging someone, it can sting no one else, and it itself dies. Now, knowing that changed my entire outlook on bees and bee stings from that time on. I mean, once I knew somebody got stung by that certain bee, it wasn't going to get me. I didn't have to run around in fear of that bee any longer. But what Jesus did through his death and resurrection should change our view of death. Death is now powerless to hurt us because Jesus Christ took its sting. And death died when it stung the Lord Jesus. It lost its power. Now, of course, death still brings heartache, and it brings tears and pain and a sense of loss to us and separation. It can bring a sense of deep loneliness and emptiness. Death can still buzz around, and it can make a lot of noise and scare us, but it can't hurt us anymore. All death can really do for the believer is just open the doorway to glory for us. The sting of death is gone. Now, the only proper response to this triumph, the death swallowed up in victory, death, where's your victory? Oh, death, where's your sting? The only proper response is thanks. In verse 57, Paul closes this classic resurrection chapter with a stirring doxology. He erupts here in celebration and thanksgiving. I want you to notice here the word victory. This is the third time it's used in verse 57. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. He used it up in verse 54. Oh, death is swallowed up in victory. He uses it in verse 55. Oh, death, where is your victory? Again here for the third time in verse 57. It's the Greek word nikos here. The word Nike comes from this. Nike was the goddess of victory. And that this word only occurs three times in all of the Apostle Paul's writings, and all three of them are right here. It's this culmination in this chapter on the resurrection, this focus on victory. And notice here he says, thanks be to God who gives us the victory. He gives it to us. It's a gift of God in Jesus Christ. We can't take any credit for the victory. We don't do anything to earn it. It's his gift to all who believe, all who will simply receive the gift of the victory that he's accomplished for us on the cross. And it's also here instructive. This is in the present tense in Greek, which means it's ongoing. The victory's already ours. We share the victory today. That future victory over the resurrection has invaded the present. It's already done. So you could translate verse 57 like this, but thanks be to God who keeps on giving the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. An ongoing victory that you and I have day to day. And notice this, don't miss this, through our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus, not death, has the last word. Jesus has the last word. I love Revelation 1, 17 and 18. The resurrected, radiant Christ appears to the Apostle John there on the island of Patmos. Remember John, the disciple Jesus loved? What's it say? He fell at his feet as a dead man. Heard someone say years ago, it's better to be dead at the feet of Jesus than alive anywhere else. Falls at the feet of Jesus. Jesus says to John, the disciple he loved, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last, the living one. Behold, I was dead, and I am alive forevermore. I have the keys of death and Hades. Jesus has the last word, not death. And through the resurrection, you and I have victory. Now, we have victory in a lot of areas. I just want to mention three things that have meant a lot to me in these last weeks. We have victory over all kinds of things through the resurrection of Jesus. But one thing is we have victory in the face of fear. We have victory in the face of fear, the fear of death. You know, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4 that people live under the fear of death all their lives. And I meet people sometimes who don't know the Lord, and they'll say, I'm not afraid to die. Well, I'll say to them, well, you ought to be. And I think down inside they are, when they're lying in bed at night alone, and they think about leaving this world and going out into a dark unknown, they're afraid. It says that the fear of death stalks people. It haunts people all their lives. But you and I do not have to fear death because Jesus is risen. My death is not final. We no longer have to fear it. Jesus has triumphed over the terror of the tomb. And I pray today if there's someone here and maybe you're getting up in years or maybe you've gotten a really bad diagnosis from the doctor and maybe death is looming for you, I pray today you can be delivered from the fear of death and know that you have victory through Christ. I read a quote by Spurgeon this week, Charles Spurgeon. I guess maybe no Easter message would be complete without a quote by Charles Spurgeon. This is a beautiful statement. I've read it over and over and over again. Let me read it to you. Death, it is true that you are not yet destroyed, but our living Redeemer has so changed you that you are no longer death, but something other than your name. Saints die not now, but they are merely dissolved and depart. Death is the loosening of the cable that the ship may sail to the fair havens. Death is the fiery chariot in which we ascend to God. It is the gentle voice of the great King who comes into his banqueting hall and says, friend, come up higher. Behold, on eagle's wings we mount. We fly far from this land of mist and cloud into the eternal serenity and brilliance of God's own house above. Yes, our Lord has abolished death. The sting of death is sin, and our great substitute has taken that sting away by his great sacrifice. Stingless, death abides among the people of God, but it is so little harms them that to them it is not death to die. It's not death really anymore for us. It's just simply the gateway to glory. Because of the resurrection, we have victory in the face of fear and the fear of death. Because of the resurrection, we also have victory in the face of funerals. Not just victory over the fear of death of ourselves, but victory over funerals when we go to the funeral of someone that we love. Again, I mentioned that my father passed away 25 days ago, and I've been filled with a great deal of sadness from that. It's an interesting time of, you know, you feel a lot of emptiness and loneliness. I never knew what it was like to lose your father. But I've experienced sadness, but I can assure you not despair. It's not despair because I know where he is and I know who he's with and I know that I'm going to be with him and I'm going to see him again. And that means the world to me. And I know it means the world to many of you as well who've been at a funeral recently for someone that you love who knew the Lord. Look, it delivers us from fear, delivers us from funerals, in the face of funerals. And we also have victory in the face of futility. You know, so many people in our world today they're depressed and discouraged. You know, suicide rates are rising. There's so much futility and vanity out there. People have this sense that life is meaningless. But look at verse 58. This is the culmination to this whole chapter. Therefore, in light of all of this, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your toil is not in vain in the Lord. Look, since death is dead, Since you and I will live again, everything we do is infused with purpose and meaning. Nothing that we do in life is futile or vain. I was reading a book this week, a great book about the resurrection. And the author tells this story I want to share with you because it really fired me up this week as I read it. It's a story about Ben Hogan. Those of you that love golf will love this story. He's been described as the greatest ball striker ever to play the game of golf. He wrote a series of five articles on the golf swing back in Sports Illustrated in the 50s, became later Ben Hogan's Five Lessons. But toward the end of the book, he writes about his own joy in the game of golf. Now, I think this is just golf. But in the final chapter of the book, he writes this. He concludes this way. I've always thought of golf as the best of all games. Whether my schedule for the following day called for a tournament round or merely a trip to the practice tee, the prospect there was going to be golf in it made me feel privileged and extremely happy, and I couldn't wait for the sun to come up the next morning so I could get out on the course again. Couldn't wait for the sun to come up, to get out and to do what he loved. And the author then says this, the mentality that says, I can't wait for the sun to come up, that's the mentality of the resurrection. He says, so when I think of always abounding in the work of the Lord, I think of Hogan and the loud cracks from his persimmon woods that echoed over the hills as he practiced each day, taking delight in shot after shot. That same kind of joy should mark our daily lives. Even if we don't have the advantage of being a professional golfer, we can always be abounding in the things that God has called us to do. And then the author concludes with these words, knowing that therefore everything we do matters. None of it is meaningless. I want to tell you today, based on the resurrection, you're not meaningless today. Your life's not futile. The author says, the life to come colors the mundane tasks of everyday life with an eternal hue. Our work becomes a symphony of praise as we labor in our calling with the sure knowledge that God is with us and for us. Look, that sun that came up on Easter morning changes everything. It ought to give us a purpose and a passion for life to get up every day and to be abounding in the work of the Lord, whatever God has given our hand to do, knowing that nothing that we do is meaningless or vain. I pray tomorrow morning you'll be excited for the sun to come up, for resurrection to come up and to serve the risen Christ and to live for Him, knowing that nothing you do in this life is meaningless or in vain. Look, because of the resurrection, you and I have victory in the face of fear and funerals and futility. It changes everything. It changes everything in our lives. There's a story I think I've told this some years ago. It's one of my favorite old stories. There's a man named Rodrigo Diaz. He was a Spanish war hero known as El Cid. El Cid in Spanish, I'm told, means the master or the Lord. When I was growing up as a young boy, I remember watching the movie. I think it was Charlton Heston and Sophia Loren. And he's the great El Cid. It was a movie that just captivated me. But this man known as El Cid was the Spanish hero in the war against the invading Moors, the Muslims from North Africa coming in to conquer Spain. And his greatest victory was at the Battle of Valencia in June of 1099 AD. The beautiful city of Valencia was on the Mediterranean coast. Moorish kings had besieged the city, and El Cid, who was 56 years of age at the time, was gravely ill and propped up there in his bed. And during the night, he gave his commanders the strategy to break the siege the next morning. So in the morning, before these Moorish kings and their troops were awake, and the commanders, they'd awakened for the morning, the Spanish commanders propped up El Cid on his horse. And they braced him in the saddle with his sword held high. And as the sun came up over the hills, they rode into the camp of the Moors, crushing them and scattering them all over the countryside. And after it was all over, it was revealed that El Cid had actually died during the night. And he told his commanders to prop up his body and brace it in the saddle with his sword held high. And his soldiers, not knowing that he was dead, were so impressed by the sight of their leader that they rode out behind him and broke the siege of Valencia. Now think about this. El Cid won his final great battle as a corpse. He won his final great battle as a corpse. But I couldn't help but see the comparison here, because Jesus is our El Cid. He's the Lord. He's our master. And he won his final battle not as a corpse, but as a conqueror, as one who conquered death and the grave. Praise God, we don't have a dead Savior. The one who leads us in triumph, he says, I was dead. Behold, I am alive forevermore. And our Lord Jesus Christ is leading us in victory every day. He's leading us in victory with sword held high. He's leading the charge. And the question for you and me is simply this: are you following him? Are you following the conquering Christ in the power of his resurrection? Are you experiencing his victory in your life through faith and trust in him each day and the hope of his glorious resurrection? Well, thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray together. If you're here today and you've never accepted that victory for yourself, I want to give you an opportunity to do that. Here's a simple verse, Romans 10:9. If you'll confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. It's that simple. You confess your mouth, Jesus is Lord. You believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. If you've never done that, come to him today and believe in him. Hang all your hope on the cross and the empty tomb. Let his victory become your victory today. Walk in victory in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Oh, Father, we come before you now. We thank you for a towering, triumphant Christ who leads us in victory. May each of us here follow him in the power of his resurrection. Oh, Father, thank you for Jesus. In his victorious name, we pray. Amen.
Would you stand and sing with us?
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease.
go forth in the power of that resurrection in this coming week. Thank you so much for being here, again, for investing your Easter Sunday with us. If you're visiting, there's a welcome center out in the lobby. You can find some information about our church. I'll be down front. Our pastors and elders who are in this service will be down front with me. We'd love to talk with you. Maybe you've accepted Christ this morning, and we'd love to talk with you about that. Well, let's bow our heads for the benediction as we leave here with the Lord's blessing upon us, that great resurrection benediction in Hebrews 13. Now the God of peace, who brought up from the dead the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the eternal covenant, even Jesus our Lord, equip you in every good thing to do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. All God's people said, amen. Amen. God bless you all. Happy Easter.